Hello folks, welcome back. Hope you gone through my previous design session. It was a design overview and I hope you enjoyed it as well. In these sessions, we will talk more about NSX-T Manager. The reason why I am doing one, obviously I have more to say about NSX Manager. I just want to make sure that this session captures some of the basics of NSX Manager. Then in the next sessions, we will talk more about NSX Manager design. So let's get started. So with this session, we will have only two topics for discussion. The first one is logical connectivity. I'm talking about IP access considerations and also the load balancing. So there are good number of considerations to make here. We will get into that shortly. After that, I will also talk about failure scenario. This is an interesting topic. You go for any customer discussions. You talk about all the product features. The final or the last questions will be how it is going to behave when there is a failure in my network. So let's get into the IP connectivity and load balancing. Here we are mainly focusing on logical connectivity part, right? If I want to make it very simple, when you are accessing your NSX-T Manager cluster, you know NSX-T Manager cluster is combined with three different nodes, three different virtual appliance forms into a cluster, that is NSX-T Manager cluster. There are three different deployment scenarios you can have here. The first one is about accessing this NSX-T Manager cluster using each of those virtual appliance nodes IP address. So this is exactly I mentioned in the diagram, three different IP address configured on your NSX-T Manager. When you are deploying NSX-T Manager, you will configure these IP addresses. If you're familiar with the controller concept, especially when it comes to SDN world, most of these SDN controllers operating model is same, right? Whether you talk about Cisco ACI or VMware NSX-T or Arista Cloud Vision, any controller you take, the model is almost the same, right? So you will have three nodes in that cluster and you will have the cluster taking care of the complete fault tolerance, replication, synchronization, all those stuff between those nodes. Three nodes are working in the background, but the UI is same. So doesn't matter whether you connect to IP A or IP B or C, doesn't matter, you get to the same graphical user interface of the NSX-T Manager. That was all about the IP addressing. Now let's understand what is L2 requirement means. Think about it, right? This NSX-T Manager, why it is three? Because in case of something happens, you have remaining nodes in the cluster taking care of the stuff. When you are designing your network, your facility, you will have a distributed design, meaning these three physical hosts will be on three different physical rack. That is how you should be doing it if you are doing it for an enterprise grade network, right? And these servers will be connected, obviously, if it is on three different rack, the servers will be connected to three different switches. So between the switches, you will have your physical network, yeah? And your servers are connected to the physical switch. In certain cases, you need to make sure that there is an L2 adjacency for the NSX-T Manager. Now, this first case, which is just going with individual IP of NSX-T Manager to manage and operate your cluster, that doesn't have this L2 adjacency requirement, right? That is the point. So if you are worried about L2 adjacency, you don't want to take that headache, the simplest option is to go with this without virtual VIP individual IPs. Let's talk about the scenario number two here with the virtual VIP. As you can see in the scenario, you have again three node virtual appliance of NSX-T Manager. Now there is a fourth IP, which is IPD, acting as a cluster VIP. So that will be a fourth IP. The point here is you don't want to access IPA and IPB and IPC for any of these three IPs to manage your NSX-T manager, right? So what you do is you create, you go for this fourth IP that is acting as a virtual IP for all these nodes. So you can connect to the virtual IP, which in turn connect to the actual IP of the NSX-T manager. Yeah, so that is the idea. I will talk about the benefit here. The benefit here is, first of all, you are keeping your actual IP hidden, could be a security thing. And the second one is, in case of IP A goes down, is not available, the WIP will be automatically give you access to IP B, or IP B goes down, redirect your request to IP C. So that is the key thing here. Your IP A, IP B and IP C and IP D should be in the same subnet, right? It should not be, you cannot keep IPA in a different subnet and IPB in a different subnet, IPC in a different subnet. That should not be the case, and that is not possible with this scenario. Now let's move on to the most advanced option, which is using an external LB. So what you do is, you, instead of using cluster WIP, you will have an external LB which will have a virtual IP. So when you connect to that virtual IP, your connections will get redirected to the actual node IP of the NSX-T manager, right? It could come to IP A or IP B. The main benefit here is, you can load balance your request to each of those NSX-T manager. You can use round robin, for example. So whenever there is someone request or there is an API call comes in, it can land in IPA or IPB or IPC. But with the cluster WIP, it works in a different way. Let's say your cluster WIP is binded to IPA. So whenever you request, the request will always go to IPA. It will not go to IPB at all. Only when IPA is not available, it will go to IPB. But when it comes to external LB WIP, that is not the case. With external LB WIP, the request can be load balanced across the NSX-T manager. And this could be a real consideration. Let's say you are having very huge request coming to NSX-T manager, maybe because you are doing some Kubernetes-based calls, you are a cloud service provider, you always want to modify, create, delete some configuration on the NSX-T, or you want to pull out some telemetry details, you are doing an API call. So think about, there are lots of requests coming to a same NSX-T manager, which may create some performance issues. So that is where your external LB scenario really helps. Now another use case of external LB, with external LB, you don't care about whether it is same subnet or a different subnet, right? It could be any subnet, doesn't matter at all. The good news is that the modern networking, if you talk about Cisco ACI, yeah, or any other solution vendors, their solutions provides VXLAN for your physical networking, which means you don't have the spanning tree issue like you were having it earlier, right? So you can easily stretch your L2, and that request will be encapsulated over VXLAN if you are passing through those physical fabric like ACI or something else. So this could be a good scenario where you can consider coexisting of your physical fabric with VXLAN and the NSX-T manager with Geneve. There could be more use cases. I'm just giving you one example. If you look at the general considerations I mentioned about the cluster WIP, now what will happen if one of the node fails when you are using cluster WIP? It does a GARP. That is how it transfer the WIP to the second or the rest of the nodes, or the one of the remaining nodes in the cluster, right? So just for your knowledge, the cluster WIP access, whenever you access the cluster WIP, we are using it is only for northbound, right? So the user is accessing, or the admin is accessing the cluster WIP, right? That is the case. Now all the communications which is happens between the nodes, between the NSX-T manager nodes, uses the node IP itself. It doesn't use the cluster wave. Yeah, just to make sure we are covering that aspect as well. Another important fact, especially when you are architecting your stuff, you need to make sure that the TCP UDP port requirements are met, especially you are remotely administering your NSX-T network. You are having a gem host, and the gem host is behind a firewall or load balancer. It has to pass through the firewall. So in that case, you need to make sure that the TCP UDP ports, which is mentioned in this specific URL, is open on the firewall or the load balancer. With this, I hope you are able to, I hope we covered all the scenarios around this logical connectivity. There are lots of other things to talk about as well. We will have following session covering those. Now let's talk about some of the failure scenarios. Yeah. So when it comes to failure scenarios, you can have three different scenarios. That's it. Maximum of three different scenarios. Yeah. How come three different scenarios? You have only three nodes, three virtual appliances in the cluster, right? So think about the scenarios which could happen, right? So the first one is, I'm talking about one of the NSX-T virtual appliances is not available. It went down, right? So what is the consequence? What will happen if one of your node goes down? Nothing will happen to your data plane for sure. Nothing will happen to your control plane. Management plane, think about the scenario in my previous slide. If you are using individual IP to manage your NSX-T, your IPA, you are accessing to manage your NSX-T, and that node goes down, that IP is not reachable anymore, right? Your management connections will not work. In that case, you need to use IPB to access your NSX-T cluster, right? So that is the only thing will happen with the scenario one, right? But if you are using cluster VIP, you are not even affected with that specific access. Always you can reconnect to NSX-T manager 2 or 3 with that individual node access, but that is a good point, right? If you are using cluster VIP or external LB, you will not even notice one of your NSX-T is down. Other than that, no issues to the management, no issues to the data plane, no issue to the configuration capabilities. You can still configure, you can still modify, you can still create, no issues at all. Now think about scenario 2. In scenario 2, we are talking about two simultaneous failure. For same time, two NSX-T managers are failed. Now, is it in the hand of a designer? I would say not usually. So whenever you design your data center, you make sure that one of the failure your solutions can tolerate. So let's get more into scenario 2. So if this happens, if two NSX-T manager nodes goes down, what will happen is your cluster will go into a state called read-only mode. That means you cannot create, modify, edit your configurations, right? You can just read. You get into the read-only mode. Now to recover from this mode, what you need to do is you need to disable the cluster functions. So the NSX-T, the third NSX-T manager or the remaining NSX-T manager will act as a individual node, right? You can always go for a single node NSX-T manager. The only thing is that it is not supported with the production deployment. In the lab, you can always have single NSX-T manager doing all your configuration and stuff. I have it in my lab. So once you have that remaining NSX-T manager taken out of the cluster, you can always edit, modify, create stuff, and you can start recovering the remaining NSX-T manager and make sure that it is again part of the cluster, right? So that is the process you need to follow. Now let's talk about scenario 3. With scenario 3, we will analyze the situations where all of your NSX-T managers are not accessible. This is really a corner case, and if you properly design your network with all power, rack, host level redundancy, this will not happen. And I never seen this happens with any of the customer in a properly designed network. Now think about software bug, but even with software bug, you will not have a scenario where all of your nodes are not at all accessible. So that is a very, very corner case. Now let's say if it happens, right? Because of some reason it is happened, then the result is you cannot configure and manage your NSX-T manager. You don't have management plane, but your data plane works fine. None of your existing flows or the traffic flow between your workload VMs will not be affected because the policies are already downloaded on the transport node. Each of the transport node is having LCP distributed. So none of your data traffic or data plane traffic is affected. So that is all about failure scenario. I hope you understand the different scenarios and design considerations. We will definitely talk about more design considerations when it comes to NSX-T manager in my next session. So hope it was useful. Thank you so much for listening. I will make sure that I'm getting you the remaining discussions and considerations shortly. Thank you so much.